sent into the practice to follow up, getting people to come in and respond to the letter, to come in for this health check or whatever it's supposed to be. Presumably, the practices, the pharmacies, we're looking for a structure that says, when we walk in the pharmacy, we see that machine that flashes in the corner and says, why don't you check your blood pressure, whatever it is, it triggers our memory. And so I did have a conversation with one of the health service officers a bit ago about what would be put on the back of a bus if we were leading a campaign for a few months. So, you know, on the back of the bus, there's the Ureva, I'm sitting behind this Ureva bus, it's a genuine one. Let's imagine, said, do you know what your blood pressure is or whatever, or should be, and when did you last have you checked? So if we're running campaigns, how do we, you know, run for 2 or 3 months on a particular subject, get people to think about what their blood pressure should be, or, and all the very little ones to see what you should be drinking in terms of units, as we try to work it all out a lot, from different levels, acceptable and not acceptable. People under-report or underestimate what they're actually drinking and all the rest of it. So for running campaigns, it's getting the thing short for snappy and meaningful to people. Now if I can't build blood pressure up to, I don't know what's going on.
Because we may be then able to set up services where we think about what we put in place to mitigate some of those consequences. If we still think it's worth doing, that would be the most important thing.
So I think, Chair, the question you asked is, do we recognise the approach? And the answer to the question is yes, it does fit with the Vanguard process. It does fit with the different model of care. And I think the work framework is really helpful, just as an example. The point I think I'd like to make is we can educate people. We can provide people with information. We can communicate a message. But truly, unless we're going to change people's behaviour by offering them a different experience, some of that messaging can fall on stony ground. And what we have to do is outline the benefit of knowing what your blood pressure is, and knowing what your salt intake is, or knowing what your fat intake is, in terms of saying, if you know these things, you will have a better experience of life, if you like. Because simply saying, and we know this with A&E, don't we, that just by simply saying, don't go to A&E, doesn't make a great deal of impact. What we have to do is offer the public a different type of experience, and through experiencing that different offer, that will change behaviour, and that will embed a different culture in society, and that's what we're trying to do. So I think this does fit very nicely with Vanguard. I think the work framework is really useful. I also think it's not just about knowing your numbers, but we ought to articulate what the benefit to you of taking control of your health and lifestyle is, and the impact that could have on you and your family. Because that, I think, will bring about a cultural change.
Seen a number of things begin to emerge, and so what enables you to do the things that you want to do, and enables you to have life opportunities that you might not otherwise be able to have. And it is about that positive concept, it's about social well-being as much as personal resources, as much as physical capabilities. And we know that what determines population health, and if you've seen the local health profile community, you can see the data in there telling us where some of our hotspots in terms of health issues are. But if you were to look at what determines that overarching population health, and this reflects the comment Julie made before, I think, actually 80% of that is determined by poverty, health behaviours and environmental risk factors. It's about 20% of population health is determined by access to good medical care. So it does make the case, I think, that we need to think more broadly. Last, King's Fund published a document called Improving the Public's Health and Resources for Local Authorities. And this year's public health is really based on that document. It's asking the question, based on the evidence provided in that King's Fund report, they looked at 9 key areas. And in it they said, what are the key things that's worth doing? What's the return on that time and energy and investment to do those things? And what's good practice, what's the evidence about what works. So we did a test to see what's going on in Europe in terms of those things. If these are the things we should be doing, and these are where we want to get to, what does it look like on Europe? So this year's Public Health Annual Report is really looking for those 9 key areas. And they, again, I think, cross-reference very clearly with the conversations we have here and the key things we want to discuss here. They are about having the best start in life, healthy schools and pupils, helping people to find good jobs and stay in work, about active and safe travel, warmer and safer homes, open spaces and leisure, strong communities with resilience, public health protection and regulation, and how we use the world that we have available to us to actually support some of those, and health and spatial planning. And I was discussing this at the Policy and Forms Committee, for example, I was saying, well, how does the council, for example, use its influence over planning and what the environment of rural will look like to promote health? So what are the opportunities there that we can take? We actually found some really great case studies and stuff that's good that's going on in the world, and that was really heartening to find. We've got things like the school hubs that are actively tackling child poverty, which is really impressive stuff there. We've got the Eat Well Wirral programme that went part of Rock Ferry, which really, I mean, in one school, we've got out of 218 family parents, we've got over 200 engaged in experience with community much better. We've got the Healthy Homes programmes going on. We've got the Reducing the Strength, we're trying to reduce the amount of super strength lager on sale, so we want to really beef that up as well. And particularly about health related workers. So there's some real examples of good stuff going on. The challenge is for us, I suppose, is about how we again make that step change. But despite all of this very good stuff, we've still got the journey to travel to get the best possible help from the people on the road. So I've gone through it, and there are specific recommendations, but I'm not going to go through all of those this afternoon. I'd be grateful if people could take away and reflect on what's needed, but do two things. One is about thinking place. So how do our long-term plans create more health promoting streets and neighbourhoods? What is it we want to see for that? So that's a particular thing in terms of those partners who could influence that. How do we deal with things like cumulative impact policies? So we see high streets with our bedding shops on, or sort of fast food outlets, is that really what our communities want to see? I suspect that is about making a contact point for our staff as well. And the other thing is about thinking around, of course, as we go through life, what are the opportunities that present themselves through the systems that either affect our life or we engage with to actually have that bit of extra value. And examples of that are things like services for parents and carers, making health and wellbeing a whole school approach in the schools, helping parents, again, with long-term jobs, which we have been with a major influence on health, and removing health related barriers to work. I think that's an area where the primary care colleagues have a role in helping them out. So I think one of the key challenges is for us, finally, is to say, how can we give people more of the building blocks they need to care for themselves and for another, and to enjoy helping people in their lives. I hope you find it of interest. There are results in there. I'm very conscious of that. It was one of those more that people are coming reports. And I'm very conscious of quite a few there. But in the other way, I would do something in there for everyone. Anyway, so not all of it might be relevant to every single department, but I would really welcome the chance to perhaps discuss it more with your partners, to see what their contribution could be, and for a debate to be had about if we're doing some good stuff, how do we do even more of it in really challenging times? And that really does mean that we have to use the evidence, and the evidence is there for what we can do. So once again, thank you to everybody who's championed reducing social isolation last year. And a big thank you, because no proper report was ever written by me. There's a lot of contribution from right across all different people. The case studies that are in there just show just how many people are engaged in the great health. And I think that's what I'm going to say, is it's not one person's job, actually, it's everybody's, and that's really impressive. You can find the report on the council website if you want to, so it's going to be available as well, and we'll be looking at that one available. The chair, thanks for the chance to introduce the public health and report, if you have to receive any comments on what it is, here it is.
Thank you, Fiona. I think it's a really well written and beautifully set up report. And the, as you say, an awful lot of facts that we've written. Any comments? Is that anybody had a chance to chat? Yes, sir.
Perhaps I should take note that just as chair of the council's cycle forum, which is becoming an active travel forum by merging with the pedestrian forum at some point. I quote, I read the section with the happy citizen riding a bicycle on page 48 and spotted that section, but it's not that long ago. I'm still getting some stickers and a number of cycle tracks that we've introduced recently where people grab me and say why aren't we mowing the potholes instead, and I defend the cyclists and the benefits of exercise and the like. I think we're still, I think cabinet members, still waiting for a report on how we're going to use £1,058,000 from what used to be Mersey Travel, which is to go into safer booster schools and walking schemes and cycling schemes, and trying to look at where we can have maximum impact on key locations to help walking, cycling and so on. And so I haven't seen that cabinet report yet, but I hope some of it gets out to the constituency forum, the constituency committees, and we can actually do key work and key projects to get people more willing to walk and cycle and things like that. So it's a subtle way of getting their blood pressure down and giving them exercise as well.
Yes, Simon.
I don't normally talk as much in these meetings, so I apologise. So you'll be rid of me soon, but actually, what I did want to say firstly was, I just find it so refreshing to say that. Cool. Thank you, and I have kind of read mostly. And we should uphold the right of the director of public health not to use in terms of disease, because that's a really important thing. But for me, it absolutely epitomises what I was trying to say not very well. think it's the point Judy made far more eloquently than me, that there are these other bits, and let's not pretend they're not there. And that doesn't mean to say we have to talk about them all here at this table, but be clear somewhere else in the partnership, somebody is dealing with them. I do think it's about giving ourselves permission around this table to challenge each other and say, for example, hey, we're doing a great job on early years health interventions, but actually we're making a real mess of, I don't know, housing environments or something. It doesn't matter what. That bit that says, unless we can give ourselves permission to challenge and we need to do that on this bit together, then we won't get that kind of one. That's what I was trying to say about the context and giving ourselves that starting point.
Thank you, Sam. If I say that, it's really good.
Chair, can I just a very quick comment? It's a really excellent report, if you know, and the way you sort of brought in all the sort of activities that are going on in primary and secondary schools is really impressive. And I mean, just the one I would pick out is the rally project, you know, that we're running in three schools. One of the schools is one of their own, the governor. And the impact has been tremendous. And basically just setting targets for all children that are the same, regardless of which area they come from. And the impact has been a 20% increase in GCSEs, A to Cs, over the last 3 years. And this year, I can say in school around the governor, that there's even a greater impact. So, you know, just very simple sort of things like, it's not rocket science, but what was happening was that children who were coming in from disadvantaged homes and we thought they were at a lower level than were in the primary school. So regardless of whether they achieved level 4 at key stage 2, when they came into the school, they said, we're all the same. So if you do need additional help, you'll get that help. We expect you to get the same, you know, your targets are going to be the same as everyone else. And that's what we did at Woodchurch High, and it's had a huge impact. And, you know, we want to try and spread that kind of practice. It is expectations, isn't it? That, you know, if you tell young people that they will achieve it, then, you know, start from the very beginning. Make sure you have the intensive support that they need from year 7, and when it comes to year 11, you'll see that the outcomes are going to be excellent. So, can I just make sort of the other area that is the early years and that, we are working on that to try and improve the sort of outcomes for children from the more disadvantaged areas and that, and you know, we're working very closely with the MP Frank Field, and that is really keen in this area. Now, over the last 12 months, we have made a big impact. I know you said 41% of children achieved the expected level at the end of the reception year, but over the last 12 months, we've managed to get it up to about 60%. And the target is 2016-17 to get it up to 80%. Because basically, if you're going to get it right at the early years, we're going to ensure that it's going to be less difficult when children move into secondary school and that. So there is a big drive in that area. But the way you've actually laid it out is most impressive.
Anyone else? Okay, thank you. Yes, John?
Just to say again, Dr. Vanguard, because this fits beautifully, and there's real alignment in this conversation, in so much that we have a tendency, I think, in the health service to talk about patients and not care, but actually Vanguard and this report is about the population of Wirral, and if we are to make a difference in our health service and social care, it is about the whole population, not just our patients. So it's a really welcome report, and we have much work to do, don't we, really, because the challenge is there before us.
Enthusiastic and lively specialist from Star, Paul Montage, who tail of how when she comes to Watsley Town Hall, she gets the 411 bus. And what she does on the 411 bus is talk to passengers about their life experience and what happens and how it works and what's been like for them. And she always comes, by the time she's got to Watsley, she always comes and tells me something about what she's learned about what life is really like for people. We're all. And I would like to say that she will be leaving soon to go to the next stage of training. She's doing a fantastic job. But I think there's something in that for all of us. You know, who are we actually listening to? You know, perhaps we should all get up on 411. She seems to learn so much from that. But there is something about this being embedded in those kind of conversations. So that I would just like to acknowledge it.
The next item of the business item, which is the Wirral new model of the Vanguard entities, which you all, I think, have on your desks, and John has tried to
look at. Chair, John has had a paper before them. So just a few issues to bring to your attention, rather than go through the whole paper. And that is, we had a very successful visit from the central support team, which was a two-day visit as part of a national programme to look at how Vanguard areas were progressing. We made a reference before to vision, and if I could just articulate where vision sits, and that is that Vision 2018 got us to the front door of Vanguard, if you like. The work that had been done in Vision 2018 brought to everyone's attention the things that we needed to do to prepare the business case for Vanguard. And I like to sort of say vision got us to the starting blocks, but Vanguard is the race we're in. So we won't be referring to Vision 2018 any longer. Vision 2018 is now Vanguard, or the new models of care. There's a couple of things in the paper just to bring your attention to, and that is the first, that NHS England and the central support team expect from us a business case to outline what our value proposition is, that's what it's called, all these phrases, we have completed an outline business case and submitted that on Tuesday last week. And thanks to colleagues who helped prepare that case, because it was submitted at 10 to 12 on Tuesday night. So you can see that many hours were burnt. And that business case really summarised all the work that's going on and had within it some detailed analysis of what we think the impact would be if we don't do anything and just carry on as we are, what the impact would be if we were to move to the new model of care. And so there's some quite heroic assumptions within that in terms of impact, as you can imagine. And some of that forecasting, modelling, utilisation analysis, changes and impact of housing, employment, etc. is quite difficult to actually model into a business case that we were given 10 days to produce. But nevertheless, we have put together a really rough outline of what we think the business case should say, and in summary, that is asking for some considerable sums of money to support dual running in order to test the case that we are making, because it's inevitable that we'll have to have dual running on some services to demonstrate impact before we can realise the benefit. That business case has not been shared widely, because it's a report to that committee, and that committee, as I understand, meets this week. Once I understand the outcome of that, obviously we'll share the outcome with everybody. So at the moment it's an internal report, it's not done in secret, it's simply a report that they asked for so that we could quantify what the impact might be, particularly in terms of resource. So for colleagues' information, we have asked, not approved yet, but asked for some £27 million worth of transitional support during the life of the Vanguard project itself. We have developed a new governance structure, which is another area that I'd like to draw your attention to. And that really is providing a governance structure which both assures what we're doing, provides a strategic direction for what we're doing, and clear about who's going to deliver which components of the programme itself. So not dissimilar to the approach that Fiona outlined before in terms of that framework. That structure and the business case and a more detailed update is going to go to the Families and Wellbeing Committee, which I believe is an all-party invitation on the 20th of July, when I'll be with Claire presenting a much more detailed Vanguard update with more specific options around what we're proposing. Finally, the programme director advertisement has gone out, so we're trying to form a small but perfectly formed project management team. That will be from a number of appointments dedicated to the Vanguard programme, but it will also be formed by contributions from around the table, where colleagues will work in kind to support the implementation of the project itself. And finally, we've had a number of engagement events. I've met with all the professional committees. We had an engagement event with the clinicians at Arrow Park on the 2nd of July, which was a really positive event. We will be holding more clinical events. What I mean by clinical events is with nurses, physios, OTs, clinicians aren't always doctors, but we hold wider clinical events. And we're also looking to have wider events engaging the whole population and do this what matters to me kind of engagement process. I truly think we need to engage in a way we've never engaged before in the world and take any opportunity to do so. And so one of the other key appointments or number of appointments within our project team will be on engagement specifically to roll that out. So there are a number of other events being planned. I think, again, a bit like UCF, we are beginning to see traction on this now. I think we have a clear line of sight to the projects that need to be developed, including buildings. clear line of sight on what projects need to be delivered and when. And the business case does actually identify what outcomes we expect and when. Resources we expect to be released from the new models of care and when, and how those outcomes and resources impact on patient experience and improve quality and when. So it's a 5-year plan. On approval from the committee that received it this week, I hope to be able to give a more detailed synopsis of it. And I would encourage people to come along, I think, I'll have to say that on the 20th. So I haven't seen any questions, but by exception, that's what the report is commended.
Thank you, Sarah.
Yes, Simon.
I have a quick question of John through you, Chair, which is, there's clearly going to be a relationship between this board and Vanguard. Is that going to be subject to the conversation you're going to take to the policy committee first?
Yes, so I indicated there was a revised governance structure. And the purpose of the revised governance structure is not just to be aware of where the assurances in the system need to be about delivery, but also reporting directly to the Health and Wellbeing Board about progress.
So, sorry, my point about that is that probably something then to come when it's been through that process, to come back and be clear on what that means, because I suspect we're not quite clear on what that means for Health and Wellbeing.
You will be clear because you know the development of the governance structure, but I am clear that it feeds into the Health and Wellbeing Board.
Could you? If I suggest that we just bring that model to the future Health and Wellbeing Board, just so we have it captured.
Thank you,
Deirdre.
So we just asked some more questions.
Will be.
be, yes.
Before you take up your new role in the Midlands. Can I just thank you for your contributions to the board and to the other people in Wirral and wish you all the best for the future. And Paul as well, I think it's your last one. Yeah. All the best for the future. Thank you very much as well.
Thank you.
Today's next meeting is we welcome the Vanguard. There is a development session in between, but not more. Thank you all very much.